Hi, I'm Jonathan Bojarski, founder of saxophonisto.com. Welcome to this special Mummer String Band edition of the series, where I talk with some of the creative minds who have helped to shape that distinctive string band sound into what it is today. Many of these folks are personal heroes of mine, immensely talented individuals who often work behind the scenes to create the incredible productions showcased at the annual Mummers Parade in Philadelphia. In today's interview, I have the distinct honor and privilege of speaking with a true legend of legends, a man who requires no introduction for those who know mummery, a personal hero of mine and to so many others, an inspiration to generations of musicians in the mummer string band tradition, a creator of some of the most beloved string band music arrangements of the last 50 years. Herb Smith changed string band music forever when he took over as music director of the Fralinger String Band in 1965, writing his first routine for the 1966 parade. Prior to Herb's arrival on the arranging scene, string band music was, as a whole, generally quite simple, utilizing relatively basic chords and, for the most part, tight, three-note triad-type voicings in the saxophone section. Herb launched the string band sound into a new stratosphere by bringing jazz rhythms, lush harmonies, and thick spread voicings into his arrangements. Herb's 1972 routine, The Golden Age of the Big Bands, was revolutionary at the time in that it brought jazz big band sound into mummery, something that really hadn't been done up to that time. Many of Herb's subsequent routines were equally revolutionary in their own right. Take, for example, 1984's The Jokers Are Wild, 1987's Cope a Banana, and 1992's Fralinger Has No Reservation. These remarkable scores, along with many others, have served as models of excellence and have provided inspiration for countless musicians and string band music fans. One of Herb's trademarks is his ingenious and skillful use of spread voicings. That Herb Smith sound is unmistakable. Instead of the closed, tight voicings of earlier string band sound, Herb opened up the saxophone section, which brought a tremendous richness, a tremendous depth and breadth to the sound. That so-called fat Herbie Smith sound will send chills down any listener's spine. It's a sound that many have tried to imitate, but few have succeeded in equaling. My interview with Herb is a two-part interview. In part one of my interview, I delve into Herb's early days in music. We talk about his early days with the Trilby String Band and how his high school friends convinced him to join Fralinger in 1959. We then discuss how Herb took over as music director in the 1960s and what it was like to be in Fralinger during this time with John Fralinger as captain and owner of the band. We talk about the band's surprise back-to-back wins in 1967 and 1968 and how Herb refined his personal sound through the 1970s. It's a really interesting look back into how it all began, and I have no doubt you will enjoy it. So sit back and relax. This is a fun journey. Enjoy my conversation with Herb Smith. Well, it gives me great pleasure to have with me today the great Herbie Smith. Herbie is a legend amongst mummers, and we all admire him. He is really considered the founding father of the modern string band sound, and it is my honor to have him with me today to talk a little bit about his background, how he got into mummery, how he got into music, and how he got into writing music. And then perhaps we'll go a little bit into Herbie's style of writing, and we'll just see where things go. Herbie, it's a real pleasure to have you here today. I'm really glad we were able to meet up and talk.
Thank you, Jonathan. Pleasure to be here.
Herbie, I want to just, let's just go back in time a little bit and talk about your upbringing. Tell me about how you got into music, your family. How did you get started?
Well, in junior high, I had a music teacher who was giving tests as to people who could become part of the music program. So it was just a very simple thing, you know, hit one note, hit another note, is that note higher or lower or whatever. So I qualified. And of course, he said, how would you like to play an instrument? I said, yeah, that's great. I said, okay. So he goes in the back and he brings out a cello. And I didn't know what a cello was. I said, my God, it looked like an oversized violin. So I said, well, if this is it, yeah, okay. So after about 2 months of carrying that thing back and forth to school, along with my books and my gym bag and all of that, I said, you know, this is not for me. And I'm passing guys on the street in South Philly. Hey, kid, how do you get that thing under your chin? So then that was it. I approached them. And I said, you know, it was a different music teacher. And I said, you know, I'm really not into this. She said, well, would you want to play another instrument? I said, sure. You know, how about a clarinet? She said, yeah, that sounds good. So she gave me this funky old clarinet. She said, listen, you take it up to this music store, leave it there or overhaul it, and then you can pick it up. So that was the beginning. And then I got into a conversation with a fellow in the neighborhood, a close friend. He belonged to the Trilby String Band. And he said, they're looking for musicians. You want to come up with me? I said, yeah, this is 1956, going into 57. So I went up, took my clarinet out, you know, sat there, okay, blah, yeah, welcome, all that. So along comes the 1957 parade. Now it's snowing, there's sleet, there's hail, it's cold. Clarinet freezes up. I'm not playing at all. Not that they missed me playing, because I didn't know what the hell I was playing anyway. It was just uncomfortable. So that was the beginning. And then as time went on, I got a saxophone, and I stayed with Trilby till last year was 1959. But they were very good to me. You know, it gave me an opportunity to start. And every time I went to a rehearsal, I wanted to be better, be a better player and everything. So I was motivated. But then I got went to school with a bunch of guys who were in Fralinger. And we had at lunchtime, we had what they called the smoke pit. At that time, it was very hip to smoke. So lunchtime, when you took a break, you went outside and you had a cigarette. So there's three friends of mine, this fella, Joe Quattrone, Bill Rochette, and Jack Biondo. Every time we went out for a smoke, it was her. Come on, you got to come to Fralinger. You got to come to Fralinger. At that time, they were setting up a trip to Cuba. I don't know whether you remember it or not. A bunch of bands went to Cuba. Come on, you know, you got to come. So I said, okay. So I went to a rehearsal with Trilby, and this very good friend took me under his wing. And I said, Homer Knappenberger. I said, Homer, I got a chance to go to Cuba with the Fralinger String Band. He says, you do what you want to do. It's up to you, the ball's in your court. So naturally, you know what happened. So I went to Cuba, and then as time went on, I started to get interested in writing, you know, but I would look at a sheet music, you know, and I say, well, let me take these notes and transpose them into saxophones, which I did. Got a small group of guys, and after rehearsal, we'd sit around and play them. And say, it's pretty good. You know, it's pretty interesting. And at the time, there were some riots in Philadelphia, and the musical director had a beer distributor place on Columbia Avenue, and that's where all the action was. So he had to give up music director job. John Fralinger said, would you like to be musical director? Well, yeah, you know. And so it went from there. You know, I started the experiment with notes, music, listening to other bands. You know how it works. You know, you try to learn from what's out there and do your own thing with it. And that's what I did. The band that I liked was Furco. Furco had very professional, very sweet sound, very in tune. Remember at Convention Hall being up in the boondocks there and watching them on the floor. I said, oh my God, this sounds like a chorus down there, you know, the way they played. Just took it from there and started to arrange, you know. And again, you know, it wasn't really in my mind as to where I was going with this thing. But I took what was out there, what was being played, and started there. And then I started to take some night courses at Coombs College of Music, which really didn't help me. I mean, they do a traditional type harmony. It's like church type harmony. So I went there for 2 years, and but the rest, it was more or less trial and error. That's where it led me. You know, I started off simple. You know, I had a great bunch of guys, because once I was asked to be musical director, a lot of guys left, but I was very lucky to have a bunch of guys that hung around with me and for years. You know, we just built on that thing. You know, we came stronger. And
now, how old were you when you took over as music director at Fralinger?
I was like 21. By the way, there was a draft, you know, and I got my draft noticed. I didn't know what to do because there were some bad things going on with Vietnam and everything. So Another friend of mine said, hey, here, Broad and Wharton, they have a sign out there. Musicians want it. 276th Army Band. So I went and knocked at the door, went up, saw the sergeant up there. And I said, I'm interested in, joining the band. He said, well, go home and get your instrument. Do you live far? No, I'm South Philly. So I got my instrument and went back, gave me a music test. He says, okay, you're in. I said, well, there's one thing I have to tell you. I've been drafted already. Don't worry about it, kid. I'll take care of it. So that I looked out there. I really did basic wow. training and played with the Army band for 6 years. So
what year was that you started in the National Guard?
Probably 61, 62.
Okay.
That's when I was lucky, very lucky. I mean, it just things fell into place. I was able to do that and then do the string band thing. Unfortunately, for the first period of time, they rehearsed on a Tuesday too, the National Guard band. So it was kind of tough. I can't call and say, I'm going to a string band. I won't be there. Nah, I don't buy that. So, it might have been a later time when I took over as musical director. Well, my first year, yeah, it was. It was 66, because that was the...
Right, because 67, you had the magic of Toyland, right? And that was your first
exactly.
routine.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah, so I was up there. I was, as a matter of fact, I was coming out of the guard band, my commitment, my tour, as they would call it. But then I just concentrated on the string band, trying to bring...
First year with Fralinger was... What was your actual first year playing with Fralinger?
1960 was okay. My first year. And the first year I arranged was 1966. And we took a nosedive. I think we got 12th, 13th, whatever it was. But...
And now we have the music men of John J. Fralinger's string band. And he has been touching the band since 1940. Still going strong. Thank you.
you know, people stuck by, and you know, we kept bringing music up every week. I would have a new tune, and which was good. And of course, you know what happened in 67, and it happened in 68. 67 was a surprise. We're at the Oregon Diner. Come in, first prize. Oh my God, the place erupted. Because they never had a first prize before. And, you know, but being the first guy out there, I say, oh, this is all right. So
that must have been an incredible experience, being not only winning first, but you're basically the second year writing for the band, you get first prize.
Exactly. I mean, I couldn't believe it myself, you know. I said, you know, it was some good competition out there, you know. It was Polish American, Quaker City, Furco, you know, just a few of the bands, you know. They were all organized, and they had good music, so we lucked out. I like to say luck, because it was kind of a lucky day for us. There wasn't any snow, by the way, or sleet, but so, you know, and then, you know, things got more challenging for the band. Other people on the outside saw that we were doing. They liked it. They wanted to be part of it, and we built from there.
Do you remember any of your first arrangements that you wrote before even 1967? Do you remember some of the first pieces that you wrote for?
First piece I did was, the band did a Sousa routine, and it was Thunder's March. You know, and I can't say it was, I created something, because it was all there. You know, all I had to do was transpose to the different instruments. And basically, at that time, there was nothing like a medley of tunes. It was like you play the tune, you stop, they would roll off, you play another tune. And I always had a vision as to why bands did that. And why not just have a flow? Some bands did have a flow of music, but there was always that interruption when the flow started. I said, you know, it'd be nice to just play the three and a half minutes, you know, without a stop, you know, like a show, like a Broadway show. So that's what we did. You know, they allowed me to do that. And
person to start really the concept of the medley in the Mummers routine.
Yeah, I think it was. I didn't want to say that, but I think it was, you know. And then other bands followed suit, you know. They liked what they heard, I guess.
Well, tell me a little bit more about 1967-68. So you were a wet behind the ears music director. You had just started the job a year earlier. All of a sudden you're winning, and then you're winning again. What was the band like then? And what did that do for your writing when you realized the band was being so successful all of a sudden?
Well, you know, it more or less formed a very tight-knit group. You know, we became very much more interested in what we're doing rather than a good time musically. Matter of fact, a funny story. I think it was Toyland. He said, hey, Herbert, there's two guys out there. They want to join the band. And we were rehearsing at the Recreation Center, 4th and Chunk. So I go out. I said, oh, you got your instruments? Yeah, blah, 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 blah. Gave him a music test. Okay, you're in. And one of them was Michael Rare. So, and he often brings that up. You know, you gave me my music test during a rehearsal in the Rec Center at 4th and Chunk. I said, yeah, you know. But then, you know, Mike was interested in the band. And you know what happened after that, you know?
Of course. With 1967 and 68, you also incorporated vocals in the show. That's something that was probably not being done very often up until that point.
What did I do with vocal? You know, you're testing my memory here.
When I listened to the recording from Association Recording, they started by singing Toyland in the very beginning.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I taught him a little harmony in there. Yeah. I don't know whether we did that at the convention hall or not. You know, the singing part.
Yeah.
But that's right. Yeah, you're right on with that.
And there was also Bells of St. Mary. There was also vocal with that.
Yeah.
Which at the time, I can't imagine there were any other bands that were doing that in harmony.
No, not really. It was simple harmony, you know, maybe a two-part, you know.
Pretty effective, and when you consider it was 1967 and most other bands were just playing three-part sax parts and maybe some singing every once in a while, but that was different for sure. All right, so you won two in a row, and the band is pretty tight, and everybody is getting along well, and you've got people that want to join the band now, I'm sure, because you've proven to be a very effective operation. What happened after that? You moved into 1969, Let a Smile Be Your Umbrella. And when I listen to that show, I start to hear the early makings of your modern sound, even though it was 1969. And while I listen to Bells of St. Mary and Toyland, I don't hear the same kinds of lines that I do in Let a Smile Be Your Umbrella, where I start hearing bass lines. You played Get Happy. You had a little bit more of a jazzy vibe to it. It seemed like that's where you were starting to define your style a little bit, to me anyway.
Yeah, it was. Hallelujah, Come On, Get Happy. We played that like a jazz feel. We're coming off of Bells of St. Mary, which was John Fralinger's wife died, and he wanted to honor his wife, I guess. So that's why we did that. So, you know, the following year, you know, he wanted something. Yeah, I wanted something to cheer him, you know, and most of the tunes are a tribute to him, you know, Let a Smile Be Your Umbrella, you know, the tunes, Rain, Rain, Go Away, you know, Little Johnny Fralinger Wants to Play, you know, at the end of the routine. I got more interested in the way things were and the way I could change them a little bit, you know, add the jazz feel.
You know, when I listened to this, if I didn't know it was 1969, I wouldn't know it was 1969. I would think it was 10 years later than that. And to, you know, I think a lot of people who aren't familiar with your early writing would hear this and think, wow, this sounds a lot more quote unquote modern than 1969. I'm just going to play a little bit of this and I hope you can hear it. So it's very Herbie. The build, right? Has a very traditional string band sound to it, but that beginning is just very you, and there it is in 1969. Holy cow.
I used that minor third modulation in a lot of our routines. They're being used today too. I don't know why, and I didn't know what it was, that minor da 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 minor third da minor third on up, you know. What was it? Old Man River, and then minor third. But yeah, you brought back memories there.
It's very effective. The bell. I'm going to play a little bit more. honestly, even listening to this, I hear a lot of your writing the lower sound, that low, really using the rich sonority of the saxes. And I don't think that there were many other people who were writing in that range, where you had the second altos / third altos down low, tenors low. People would worry that it might be muddy, but you used it very effectively. And again, it's 1969. Obviously, you proved that to be very effective over time, but it's really interesting to hear that.
It had a lot to do with the key. At that time, the musicianship, you know, to play up around the high C, high A, anything above high, it got a little, ooh, you know, intonation-wise. So sometimes it's the key that dictated the depth of the tune. You know, you were able to have that depth in there. But later on, I split that. You know, I maintained the third altos and then opened the harmonies up rather than have the tight harmonies, allowed the tenors to more or less be the trombone of a big band, you know, playing backup harmonies, backup lines. Is that a sure recording?
It is. And I want to hear a little more about those recordings a little later on. But as I prepared for this interview, I've been listening to this, trying to hear the evolution of your sound over time. And I want to get into that a little bit more with you. But that year in particular, 1969, it was a very different sound. So after that, you did Smile, Let a Smile Be Your Umbrella, and then you moved on to the Italian routine, right?
That was a challenge, you know, trying to pick tunes that were more or less familiar, not only to the Italian community, but pop Italian songs, you know, and the traditional Italian songs. We had a meeting one Tuesday, and John Fralinger said, "I want to talk to you and the committee in the back room." And he said, "I want to do an Italian theme." He said, "But I don't want to use the word Italian." Now, this, we already had the music. And I said, "Well, John, how about Italian songs, old and new?" That's it. The word Italian was right there. He said, "That's it." You know, so, you know, I was still writing, you know, three part in a lot of the arrangements, you know, and again it was the range of the tune, just to keep that bottom penetrating. It was a good year for us.
John Fralinger owned the band at that point, right?
Right, yeah.
So how did that
change? You know, as the band was progressing, the band wanted more demand from the leaders, and John being the leader. When we would go out convention hall, all other bands would have food, and the women were cooking food, and we had nothing. You know, after the show was done, that was it, you know. So some of the guys approached him and said, "John, you know, can't we have hot dogs or something like that?" "No, no, we're not going to have anything." And that's what started it, believe it or not. You know, this I'm in charge thing. You know, the guys we're getting more talented people into the band. A bunch of guys got together and just started the ball rolling. You know, they didn't want to throw John out. We had to be more democratic, you know, more from the membership as to the way things could be. But him being the leader that he was, you know, it was my band and nobody else's band. So it got messy there for a while. And then it went to court. And finally his lawyer said, you know, John, you know, sell the thing. You know, you're up in age. So he put a figure on it, $10,000, which at that time was a lot of money. And we had two guys that backed it and more or less put up their money. And we bought the band. But over hot dogs, you believe it? I mean, there was nothing. He had a place, John. You know, you could be captain for life. You know, it's your band. You started it, but didn't want it. So, but you know what happened after that? You know, band more or less took off. You know, guys got control of the band and built it into a real association.
And musically, the band continued to be, I guess, very strong because you went from, I guess after the Italian year, you then moved on and did Sousa number two, right? That was your Sousa theme, the second one.
Yeah. Fralinger being the captain, and he was portrayed as John Philip Sousa, which he loved, you know, put the beard on him and well, you know, the suit committee wanted to do something else. And then he said, look, Let's do this, Sousa, and you can do whatever you want in 72.
Yep.
Okay. So that's what we did. You know, we did the Sousa thing.
Ninth in the string band line, John J. Fralinger string band. We talked with John Fralinger recently. He's a Pennsylvania Auditor General's office. He works there. And we asked him why he took the March King, John Philip Sousa, as the theme.
We felt as though that this was a time to bring it back again because I think something like this was needed in America. We're two better Americans to show us people, show the people in America who are really Americans what America is like. And I think John Philip Sousa with his music portrayed it.
I'm sure that John Fralinger is happy to be back marching on Broad Street this year. He's become known as Mr. Mummer.
They are for real.
Big band happened, you know, which was really, I don't think I've ever experienced something like that on Broad Street, where people just came out in the street and started to dance when we played In the Mood. You know, that was the kicker for the routine.
Thank you.
A lot of and people universally refer to that year as a real game changer. When I speak with other arrangers about the evolution of string band, they really view that year as a turning point.
Yeah, things started to happen, and bands started to play routines, and of course, you know, there were certain guys, it's not string band, you know, it's not a string. Well, I know, yeah, but times have changed, you know, we're in a different era here. So
I'm going to put a little bit of the big band routine up right now. And by the way, that was a year you scored a perfect score in music.
I didn't know that, by the way, but I'm glad you brought it up.
You did. Those were very different transitions from Mummers at the time, I would think. You know, that mm-hmm. sort of a transition was not something that other bands were playing. I'll play it again, and that goes into your sing-sing. Again, when I listen to your writing here, it's using a lot of lower voicings that, I think that if we heard another band playing Sing 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 in the 70s, they wouldn't have voiced it like that. This is a very different style where you were using
the moving parts underneath.
Right. So it's interesting to hear that. But what a great sound at the time. And again, to think that was only 1972, for heaven's sake. So the band was very popular on the street in 1972, huh? In the Mood drove the crowd crazy.
Oh yeah, it's and even at Convention Hall when we went out there, we got a standing ovation every night when playing In the Mood, because most of the people probably could identify that. You know, happy times after, you know, during a war, it was after, and brought back memories for a lot of people.
Yeah, and it wasn't that long after the war at that point, right? So a lot of people who were of that age. Did the band, did you bring in a lot more musicians, quality players, even more than you already had as a result of that sort of music, do you think? People started hearing your sound and saying, I want to be a part of that?
That's exactly what happened. You know, they wanted to be part of that music. And most of the bands were stuck in what they've been doing for a long time. Things started to change with other bands, too. You know, the not that we were winning, you know, we had a dry spell there for a long time after that. And we just kept going, you know, musically, you know, it didn't bother our guys, you know, okay, we got, you know, but that following Tuesday, I'd have a new tune, you know, and it was a new year.
I think you know, this era of time where you were just really evolving, I think, in your sound a whole lot, with the songs you'd write, the street songs you'd write, just the things you'd bring around after New Year's, were you experimenting at all with different sounds? Were you trying different things and seeing, well, does this work? How does this work?
Every time I wrote an arrangement after that, it was, you know, experimental, you know. It was new to our guys, and it was a learning process for myself. You know, listen to it, see what can I do differently. And the more we got better musicians, the more challenging the music became. It was both teaching me and teaching the guys who weren't really, they were just, it was a hobby. They weren't, half of them weren't taught. It was self-taught, you know, taught themselves and then learned how to read music and everything. So all around, everybody, it was a learning experience for everybody.
There's an album you guys recorded called Fralinger Goes Pop. And when I listen to that, I hear a lot of experimentation in there. And it's, for those who've not heard that recording, it's worth a listen because it feels like experimental string band music. Mm-hmm. And the things that you were doing there, it just seems like you were really trying to push the envelope to what the band could do. You know, there are different, a whole range of styles from Romeo and Juliet. Here's a little bit of, I'll play a few little samples from that recording, which are just very, very different for the time and pushing the envelope. It was very orchestral, a lot of the things you did on there, and I don't think you even had drums on a lot of the songs. It was just a very orchestral recording, unlike anything that I'm sure many had heard before.
You know, you brought the drums up, you know, in that 1972 routine, when I was doing the music for it, one rehearsal. The guy came up to me and said, "You know, Herb," he says, "I can work set like a trap up with a snare and a cymbal." And that was the first time I think it was ever used by a band that, you know, they started to add the cymbal sound. But anyway, I want to throw that out to you.
Yeah, even then it just seemed like there was a lot of drum experimentation that was happening.
Yeah, sometimes you don't need percussion. You know, you just want the horns to sing, and sometimes you have to control that bass drum player because you got guys pulling on the bass fiddles, and they just wipe the whole fiddle line out.
That's good advice for bands, though. And I think that's a good pearl of wisdom. So we'll move on in time a little bit, and you did the big bands, then you did Mardi Gras, and Mardi Gras was experimental too, because you were using sopranos as clarinets, right? And I don't know if any other bands had taken sopranos down the street on New Year's Day, but you certainly did.
No, it was the first. We had three of them. You imagine
you
three sopranos trying
sopranos
to
play, down? Boy, that was gutsy.
Trying to play in tune in cold weather. In warm weather, they're hard to play in tune, you know, let alone cold weather. But it was interesting.
And those lines were, you know, for 1973 Mummer string bands, pretty jazzy lines for the time. So you were taking things in those directions that other bands were not, I'm sure.
Well, you know, we did Mardi Gras again, and I listened to it on YouTube, and I kind of stepped back and I said, you know, that wasn't bad at all. You know, the band was really cooking. And did Sweet Georgia Brown again.
Like it, I feel like it just, you took every, the essence of every nugget of the best of that song and you just packed it in there and then you just threw your own stuff in there and just smashed it all together into this great version of that tune.
Seems like that were always nice to work with because there was an abundance of music and you could really have fun with it. Not getting away, like little bits of tunes that still identify who you are. Way down yonder, new, and then revisit it on the recap at the end of it. They were fun. Some themes were just so easy. There was a whole lot of music, and people related. Most people knew all the tunes. That were done. Some themes, you know, you really had to think, you know, okay, what do we do with paint? What kind of tunes do you do with paint? You know,
yeah.
It was tough.
Yeah, some tunes write themselves almost in terms of just
getting
the songs. The songs are so easy to put together in terms of the list of songs, not necessarily the arrangement. But, well, the 70s were a real period of evolution for you. And to think you going from 67 to 77, the change in Fralinger's sound during that period of time was quite dramatic, really. So it's clear that you were doing a lot of interesting things and experimenting a lot and finding your sound.
Well, a lot of learning in there for myself, too. You know, wanted to make it challenging, and I have my own ideas, but we had to test it. You know, we had to test the waters as far as being different, you know. Getting more recognition for ourselves.
Before I move forward, who would you say some of your musical influences were outside of string bands, either to this day or back in that period of time, your non-mummer musical influences?
Mostly jazz players. Mostly, you know, Sonny Rollins, Sonny Stitt, Bird. And we talk when we were having breakfast about certain arrangers. Tammy Nestico, guys like that. Saying, man, how's he do that? Tune after tune comes up with these fantastic arrangements.
Right.
But that's the fun of it. You know, you take a mediocre tune and say, okay, what can I do with this? You know, what do I hear?
What were some of the other string bands in the 70s that you were, that you viewed as your competition and you were listening to at the time?
Polish American, when Ray Malik. Some of his routines were very interesting. And of course, Furco, you know, they still maintain that sweet sound. And what was the band that won Harrogate when they won? You know,
yep.
Everybody thought it was a fluke, how music changed. Well, wait a minute, they got dancers out there?
Thank you.
And then the next year they went again and they got dancers out there. We got to get some dancers out there. you know, like music, you know, if what it is today, you know, certain bands are very capable now of playing some very difficult music. Of course, you got a lot of these kids that are very talented also. They're more schooled than we ever were, you know.
I hope you enjoyed part one of my interview with Herb Smith. It sure was fun talking with him. In part two, we'll take over where we left off in the early 1980s, the beginning of one of several golden ages of the Fralinger String Band. We'll delve into Herb's winning 1983 and 1984 arrangements, how they came about, and look at how his sound evolved over time. You'll love it, so keep your eye out for part two coming soon. And I really hope you're enjoying these. As always, let me know. If you have any comments, questions, or suggestions, I'd love to hear from you, and please share them with others who you feel may be interested in seeing them. All right, bye for now, and I'll see you soon.
Your attention, please. Now get a recorded souvenir of the 1978 Philadelphia Mummers Parade and String Band Show of Shows. Just released in limited quantities, the all-new Best of the Mummers 17th Annual Musical Salute Shore Album, containing two long-playing records for the price of one. 103 great tunes, over 1 hour of music, saluting 16 champion string bands. $16 value, now yours for only $7.98. This album will not be available in stores. Also available on 8-track stereo or cassette tape, just $8.98. Rush your check or money order to 1978 String Bands, Box 7775, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. That's Box 7775 in Philadelphia.